The nominees for Best Motion Picture are...
The 5th Academy Awards upped the Best Picture nominees to 8, the first such increase that would happen over the next few years. Adapted from the 1925 Sinclair Lewis book of the same name, which won the 1926 Pulitzer Prize before Lewis turned it down, 1931's Aerosmith is about young, big-eyed, idealistic Dr. Martin Aerosmith, played by Ronald Colman. In his early days working at a hospital, Aerosmith falls in love with Leora, a nurse played by Helen Hayes. To financially support his marriage, Aerosmith turns down the job of a meagerly paid research assistant to noted bacteriologist Dr. Max Gottlieb, played by A.E. Anson. Aerosmith and his wife move around a lot as the doctor gets restless time and time again as his prospects as a medical man keep going the wrong way. Aerosmith serves as a small-town doctor who loses a child to sickness, and a veterinarian who discovers the serum for a cow illness before finally circling back to the job as a research scientist, joining Gottlieb at the renowned McKirk Institute in New York. But Aerosmith can't seem to find fulfillment there either.
Just scared me to death to see you this way.
Well, you won't be scared much longer, Lee. Oh, I've made up my mind to check it, Lee, before they fire me. I've been down there 2 whole years and haven't accomplished a darn thing. Oh, I'm no good. I'm worse at science than I was at doctoring.
Well, you mustn't say such things, Martin. I won't have it. Why, for all you know, you may be on the verge of a great discovery this very minute. I've got a kind of a feeling that you are.
Oh.
Oh, now, don't look at me like that. I mean it.
Aerosmith stumbles upon a mysterious antibiotic serum that could hold the key to curing notable diseases. After a breakout of bubonic plague in the West Indies, remember, effective plague treatment wasn't fully developed by this point, Aerosmith and his wife travel there to help quell the spreading illness. This doesn't work. Colman and Hayes share no chemistry, and their romance is given no time to develop before the story thrusts them into a marriage, Aerosmith proposing on their very first date. They're in love because the movie says so, not because any of their interactions do.
Ah, Lee, I love you so. Even if this darned work does tie me up, I know I've been neglecting you. But when this is over, I'll take time off every day, and we'll go to the movies, and we'll have friends in. And I'll send you flowers every morning. Nice, big red roses. I'll even learn to play bridge. Ah, stand by, old girl. You have some coffee?
You got the nastiest way of treating me, Martin Aerosmith. As if I wanted flowers every morning when all I want is for you to take care of yourself. You're a rotten husband. I'd rather have you than all the decent ones in the world.
This movie's primary emotional force is the romance and what great lengths these two will go to for the one they love. But since I never for one second believed they were in love, most of the drama and tragedy felt empty to me. The movie is too focused on getting us to the next plot point to ever spend much time on anything that happens. I wonder if this adaptation is trying to cram too much of its source material into an hour and 48 minute film. It's almost impossible to get invested in anything that's going on, because as soon as you do, we're moving on to something else. To emphasize the poor scripting even further, with 25 minutes to go, the film throws Myrna Loy into the mix as a sultry woman in the West Indies. You think this will start off a love triangle between Colman, Hayes, and Loy, but instead Loy looks at Colman seductively a few times, and nothing ever comes of it. This is because her character from the novel was whittled down to almost nothing. You could eliminate all her scenes in the finished product, and affect nothing. This horrible handling of plot is especially glaring when you consider this was directed by the great John Ford, who apparently rushed portions of filming so he can get the movie done quicker and go back to drinking. And boy, does it show. About the only credit I can give the man is his work with cinematographer Ray June, who occasionally gives us something nice to look at. Colman and Hayes give unrelatable performances. Colman always feels like he's acting, and Hayes overdoes it far too often.
I've come here to look after you. How can I look after you if you leave me behind?
I'll be all right, sweetie.
How do I know that? It might get you. And if it did, there's nobody but me could nurse you. And even if it didn't get you, Martin, I'd go mad being without you. I mean it, I'd go mad. Oh, can't you see? I haven't got any life beside you. I'm you and I've got to be with you. You can't leave me behind.
Lee, sweet. Be reasonable. We don't know where we'll be living or what we'll be getting into. I daren't take you along with me. It's no place for a woman.
Darn being a woman.
Give me the comfort of knowing you're safe.
Most of the cast is like this, inducing boredom or eye rolls into their audience instead of emotions. One actor I will highlight is Clarence Brooks, who plays Dr. Oliver Merchant, a medical man assisting Aerosmith in the West Indies. Brooks portrays a well-educated black doctor with none of the racist stereotypes that were all too common in the 30s. He's allowed to be a person, with his race never being mentioned by Aerosmith or anyone else. So Aerosmith the film scores a point for progress. Aerosmith is far from horrible, it's far from great. It's possibly in the worst spots. It's middle of the road and forgettable. Anyone's Bad Girl was adapted from a 1928 novel by Vina Delmar and a 1930 play by Delmar and Brian Marlowe. The movie follows a young couple, Dorothy, played by Sally Eilers, and I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing that, and Eddie, played by James Dunn, as they work their way through the trials and misunderstandings of their relationship. The drama first begins when Dorothy is banished from her apartment when her brother believes she slept with Eddie out of wedlock after an all-nighter at Eddie's apartment. Their further relationship troubles mainly stem from poor communication and the two's mistrust of the opposite sex. This results in Eddie missing dates.
Hey, you got a lot of nerve letting me stand out there in the pouring rain.
Gee, I didn't know it was so late. I got to fooling around with this thing. Ain't it a pip? It'll bring in anything from KGO to L2O.
No kidding.
Yeah, sweet job, huh? Come here and I'll show you what I had to do with it.
What do I care what you had to do with it? I'm not Marconi or Edison or whoever invented the thing. I'm standing
all
out there.
All right.
Dorothy believing Eddie skipped town the day they're to be married, Dorothy not telling Eddie she's pregnant because it would stop him from opening his dream radio shop, and Eddie buying a house without telling Dorothy because he wants to surprise her with the better living that he thinks she wants when she's actually worried about supporting their unborn child. The two work through these tribulations with love and the aid of a sassy friend, Edna, played by Mina Gombell. Bad Girl was directed by Frank Borshaj, and I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing that, the man behind previous Best Picture nominee Seventh Heaven. We're in similar-ish territory as the 1927 film, with Borshaj examining another romantic relationship. This one is rockier, if less dramatic, and I don't mean that in a bad way. Where Seventh Heaven's canvas was large in terms of love and a little bit of war, Bad Girl is small and focuses on the couple's misunderstandings. I like and don't like this. Bad Girl shows a successful but struggling relationship. It's truer to life and features more relatable issues. Our leads work out their problems like any of us would without anyone having to leave the other to create drama. What I don't like is that a lot of these small, everyday problems rely on misunderstandings to create the conflicts. Misunderstandings are fine, if not my cup of tea. I think Borshaj wants to portray two people who are so untrusting of the other sex that they're terrible at communicating with each other.
She read about you in the paper, Dr. Burgess. While, of course, we never thought we could get you. She was saying that it would be swell if she could get a guy like you to be with her.
Did you tell her you were coming to see me?
No, sir. She and me ain't been getting along very well lately. I've been working nights and I didn't tell her about it. She thinks I've been chiseling on her, I guess. I can't tell things like that. I'm kind of a mug that way.
That's all well and good, and a topic well worth exploring, but Borshaj doesn't explore it. Not really. He shows it, but there's no deep dive into it, nor do Dorothy and Eddie learn any lessons about communicating. I can't help but be left with any other impression but them continuing to misunderstand the other's thoughts, feelings, and intentions. They're keeping happy, yes, but there's no human growth. That being said, this is a sweet film. Borshaj excels at these kind of romances, and they truly warm the heart. While I could have done without Eddie's remarks at the beginning of the film...
Well, if you don't want them to fight with you, what are you dressed like that for? You wear those clothes for what? To show off the curves of your body. Look at the waist. What cut so low for? Yeah, so some guy can get an eyeful. And your dress is deliberately made for the wind to blow up over your knees. Listen, sister, if you don't want guys to salute you... Take down your flag.
I couldn't help but love this softy with the fake hard edge. He's just so cute. Yes, he could consult his wife before being rash and buying a darn house, but I still root for the character every step of the way. Dorothy is also lovely, but her habit of thinking the worst and giving up so easily can frustrate.
For goodness sake, take that long face off. This is your wedding day, not your funeral. He'll be here. There's a mistake somewhere, that's all.
Yeah, last night. That was the mistake.
Despite irking elements, this is well worth your time if you want some warm fuzzies. The Champ, a 1931 film written by Francis Marion and Lennon Praskins, tells the tale of former heavyweight champion Andy Purcell, better known as Champ or The Champ, who's hit a rough patch after his alcoholism led to a career freefall.
Booze fighting and box fighting don't mix, you know that.
I don't get you.
Why, you're cockeyed right now.
What do you mean I'm cockeyed?
Just like you were the night you lost the championship.
Yeah?
Ah, sit down, you big palooka. Get the mug.
He attempts a comeback to regain the respect of the community and his son, Dink, played by Jackie Cooper. Dink idolizes his father, but abhors his drinking. Dink's long-lost mother, Linda, played by Irene Rich, re-enters the picture with her wealthy second husband, Tony, played by Harold Hamilton. Linda wants to be part of Dink's life and offers to take him in so he can get away from gambling and drinking and get a proper education. Champ refuses, determined to reclaim the world title and do right by his son. Director King Vidor should be commended for getting such great performances out of his cast, because they sell what's really a standard redemption story. I was surprised that despite this coming out only 7 months after previous Best Picture nominee Skippy, Jackie Cooper moved beyond the cute little boy who cries a little bit acting into a sophisticated performance.
You got a cold, ain't you?
No, I'm just sort of crying.
No, you ain't. Gee, boy, but you look swell. Ain't much life to a suit of clothes. Ain't so bad. Oh. Why, you had a manicure.
What happened to your hand?
Oh, I just scratched it a little bit.
Been feeling all right again?
Sure, I'm feeling fine. Gee, I'm feeling great.
And Barry, it isn't a powerhouse performance. He doesn't floor me, but in a way, I think that's a compliment. Barry isn't overly showy. He unassumingly presents a flawed, broken man trying to do best by his son. Like here, where he reluctantly tells Dink that he has to go live with his mother. So Dink will go, Champ lies about the reasons, saying that he doesn't want Dink hanging around him all the time and eating so much food.
I won't need so much, Champ. And I won't hang around you. I'll stay up with the Greeks and wait till you come home nights.
No.
I wish you wouldn't send me, Champ. Gee, I'd go to school here. The father's asked me a lot of times. I could grow up to be somebody. Somebody like you.
No, You're going to go to your mother's.
He and Cooper have genuine chemistry, and it's surprising they didn't get along in real life, because you feel nothing but warmth and dedication in their scenes together. I enjoyed the movie's story about second chances. I think it's slightly undone, though, by a downbeat ending which does and doesn't give Champ what he wants. The universe almost cruelly laughs at Champ and Deke as it rips away all they achieved. I guess you could call it tragedy, but it seemed a touch mean and unfitting when compared to the optimistic tone set earlier. So maybe you shouldn't go into this seeing it as a redemption story. Instead, look at it as a beautiful, if times heartbreaking, story of the rocky but loving relationship of a father and son who want happiness for the other. Barry and Coogan's performances and interplay make that story a must-watch, and Vito does what he made a career doing, telling a compelling, sympathetic, humanist narrative. Five Star Final was based on a 1930 Broadway play by Louis Weizenkorn, and I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing that. It follows Joseph W. Randall, played by Edward G. Robinson, the managing editor of tabloid newspaper The Evening Gazette. Randall stands for the ideals of journalism and is working on legitimizing the paper with well-sourced and well-written pieces, while the paper's owner, played by Oscar F. Fell, is out to make money through any exploitative means he can.
We cannot afford to become sentimentalists. Yeah. I think that we can lift our circulation and at the same time raise sex to a dignified attitude.
By another constitutional amendment?
Well, for example, suppose a girl gets into trouble on an automobile ride. I want a reporter to see that girl's mother. I want the moral values of the story brought out. If the mother has warned the girl against going riding with strange men, then it's a lesson for other daughters. If she hasn't warned her, then it's a lesson for mothers.
Very well, Mr. Hinchcliffe. The Gazette shall return immediately to its old ideals.
His new idea is a retrospective series on a 20-year-old murderer. The murderess was Nancy Voorhees, played by Frances Starr, who shot her boss after he went back on his promise to marry her. The jury acquitted her after taking sympathy on her pregnancy. Nancy now lives a quiet life under the name Townsend with her husband Michael, played by H.B. Warner, her daughter Jenny, played by Marion Marsh, and her daughter's fiancé, Philip, played by Anthony Bushell. Randall reluctantly goes along with the story, much to the disapproval of his wisecracking secretary, Miss Taylor, played by Aileen McMahon.
Now look here, Mr. Randall. You've done a lot for me. But all the time you've been doing something for me, you've been doing something to yourself.
Hey, what are you talking about?
You're letting this rag seduce you with a lot of money.
Say, now listen. I've been on enough newspapers and I've seen enough people to know that ideals won't put a patch on your pants. You think this Voorhees story is a pretty filthy mess, don't you?
I think that woman suffered enough. She had a right to kill that man. We're putting her on trial again. Sneaking around about it with morals and warnings to young girls. Can't you see what this might do to her family?
Aiding the story is the creepy, womanizing, and probably guilty of sexual assault reporter T. Vernon Isabai, played by Boris Karloff, and young journalist Kitty, played by Ona Munson. Kitty breaks into the couple's house to take photographs, and Isabod poses as a priest to gain the family's trust and learn information for the series. When they learn of the story, Nancy and her husband grow fearful for what this means for their lives and for their daughter, who's unaware of her mother's past, and Jenny's upcoming marriage into Philip's well-to-do family. Five-star finale is what I like to call the front page done right. Those who've watched the fourth entry in this series will know that I hated 1931's The Front Page, which was a dark comedy about morally questionable journalists. Almost everyone in it was a jerk, and unfunny jerks at that. It was a miserable experience that didn't work for me. While Five Star Finale certainly has black humor moments, it mostly plays it straight as a drama examining the darker sides of journalism, especially tabloid journalism.
Now that our mother is dead, there isn't anybody to deny anything that we may print. So, I suggested that we give the poor child, say $1,000 for her permission to run her mother's own authorized store.
Oh, I think we could give the unfortunate daughter a little more than that. Say $1,200. Now, what do you think of the plan?
I think Isabod's got a good idea.
It's a swell chance for us to cash in.
Lives can be ruined by reporters, editors, and publishers who manipulate for profit while failing to recognize the human side to what they're doing.
And you own this paper. You write editorials and sign them. You attack everything. You're a crusader in shining armor.
Miss Townsend, you must understand that I am not forced to listen to you.
What will you do?
I have told you how sorry I am. That anything that I can do, I...
You can do anything, can't you? I read your newspaper. It solves everything. It tells the President of the United States how to stop war. It tells women how to raise babies. It tells us to shorten our skirts or bob our hair or lengthen both. Do you think I care what you feel? You've smashed us!
Yes, and I like that there were more sympathetic characters like Randall, Taylor, and the Townsend family, but even if they, except for I guess the Townsends, were terrible SOBs, if the message of destruction in the wake of shellfish, irresponsible journalism had remained intact, I would have still enjoyed the movie. It's the message that I'm keying into. The front page didn't really have any meaningful point to latch onto beyond journalists are lying a-holes, which is too shallow a point for me to care much about, no matter how true it might have been at the time. Five Star Final is nothing groundbreaking, but its message remains imperative. Based on the 1909 play Only a Dream by Lothar Schmidt, 1 Hour with You from 1932 is about married couple Andre, played by Marie Chevalier, and Colette, played by Janet McDonald. Colette's old friend Mitzi, played by Genevieve Tobin, is coming to town. Professor Oliver, Mitzi's husband, played by Roland Young, is investigating his wife for infidelity. The professor's suspicions appear justified as Mitzi begins hitting on Andre. Andre, an area doctor, tries to resist Mitzi's advances and stay loyal to his wife. Meanwhile, Mitzi plants seeds of doubt in Colette's head, saying Andre is cheating on her with someone else they know. Another tempter is lurking about as Adolf, a friend of Andre, played by Charles Ruggles, starts making advances on Colette. Tensions, misunderstandings, and mistrust erupt at a party Andre and Colette are hosting as the four run around avoiding or seeking out each other. Ernest Lubitz, director of previous Best Picture nominees The Patriot, 1928, and The Love Parade, 1929, was originally set to direct One Hour With You and worked on it during pre-production. After his 1931 film Broken Lullaby went over schedule, he was forced to drop out and George Cukor took over. Cukor didn't get along with Chevalier, and Lubitz was brought back on. Lubitz and Cukor ended up in court over who should get directing credits, and eventually the court ruled in Lubitz's favor, giving Cukor an assistance credit. I wonder if these directing hiccups contributed to the production's unevenness. Chevalier does have some really funny moments in the beginning.
Darling!
That's for me. Sweetheart! That's for her. I'll be with you in a minute. That's for both of us. Vive la France!
But even Chevalier's charm and wit suffer in this unpleasant film. I'm sorry, but I don't find Chevalier charming or funny anymore when he has songs like this.
If her head was on your shoulder, and she grew a little bit bolder, oh, I ask you, what would you do with a girl like that? Do you think you could resist her? Do you think you wouldn't have kissed her? Would you treat her like a sister? Oh, come on, be honest, mister. If you had a sweet and pure wife, wouldn't you be faithful to your wife? Now, I ask you, what would you do? Hey, that's what I did too.
You could say Andre trying to excuse away his infidelity is just a character flaw, but that's not how I interpreted it in this film. I think that is backed up by Lubitz's old-fashioned and problematic gender dynamics in some of his films that are rather sexist towards women and let men get away with too much. I can no longer go, oh, those charming cads, when a movie says men can't control their lust, doesn't hold them accountable, and everyone, women included, are maddening and horrible people. Adolf is a creepy stalker.
I'm dying for One Hour With You.
Adolf, the party's over.
I've got to pour my love out to you.
What's the matter with you?
I'm just insane
Adolf,
with desire. I'm on fire. Have a heart.
Mitzi is an awful, unfaithful friend who cares nothing about anyone's feelings while she uses and manipulates them for her own gain.
Have you heard anything? Not Colette, darling. I believe Andre is absolutely faithful. I don't care what people say.
And Colette doesn't trust her husband, immediately and easily believing him of infidelity.
If I wanted to start something with Mademoiselle Martel, would I do it here? Couldn't I call her to my office?
So, that's what goes on in your office.
Darling, we have been married for 3 years.
And for 3 years you've gone to your office every day.
Sweetheart, take my word. This Martel girl...
I don't believe you.
The only one I was rooting for by the end was Professor Oliver, and he wasn't even that great of a person either. I just felt bad they had to put up with Mitzi's adultery as long as he did. It's a shame because Chevalier and McDonald have great chemistry together, and it's sad to see their relationship devolve into mistrust. In the early scenes, the two are positively adorable together.
Oh, darling, I forgot to tell you.
Tell me, sweetheart. Tell me.
You know who's coming tomorrow for lunch?
Sweetheart, tomorrow morning, when the sun is shining and the breakfast is on the table, and the little birdies are singing in the trees, I want you to tell me all about it. But not now.
But, darling, you don't even know who it is. It's Mitzi. My old school chum, Mitzi.
Not Mitzi.
Yes, Mitzi.
Oh, Mitzi.
One of the few saving graces of One Hour With You was the music. One of the early numbers, We Will Always Be Sweethearts, endears you to Chevalier and McDonald right away and shows you why their pairing was so popular with audiences of the time.
We don't have to hide in a secret rendezvous.
In the best hotel, we could get a suite for two.
But it's not a sin.
And it's full of spice.
But it's lawful.
And it's awful nice. What a little thing like a wedding ring can do.
3 times a day is one of the few times Andre's conflict with Mitzi works, as you can see him trying to politely avoid her flirtations while she simply doesn't care about him being uncomfortable.
I know it can't be chronic, but if you feel this way, perhaps you need a little tonic 3 times a day.
My head is simply reeling. Oh, doctor, don't delay.
How often do you get this feeling?
3 times a day.
You seem to be in perfect shape, as far as I can see.
Are you a doctor or a saint? Hold me, please. I'm going to faint.
You surely need attention.
Do something right away.
Now, just take two of these in water 3 times a day.
There are numbers I don't like, such as this odd one, where McDonald and Tobin aren't even really singing the song, but rhyming, like this was a Dr. Seuss story.
Oh, I must show you my new lingerie.
Too stunning for only a husband to see.
Those dresses, how thrilling.
Yes, they're really quite fair. I was just telling Andre I've nothing to wear. Of course, these are his.
Oh, they're as cute as can be. But where is the rest of them? Oh, pardon me.
But despite some good songs and funny moments littered throughout, 1 Hour With You was still an unpleasant movie about unpleasant people doing unpleasant things to each other. This was not one of Lubitsch's best. Or should I say Cukor. Based on Harry Hervey's 1931 short story, Sky Over China, also known as China Pass, Shanghai Express is a 1932 film that marks the fourth of 7 movies German director Joseph von Sternberg and German actress Marlene Dietrich collaborated on. It follows an ensemble of characters as they travel on a train across China from Peking to Shanghai. Our lead is Shanghai Lily, played by Dietrich, and British Captain Donald Doc Harvey, played by Clive Brook, whose previous romantic relationship with Lily, now a courtesan famous across China, boils to the surface when the two reunite on the train.
It was difficult to find someone to take your place.
Did you try very hard?
Not particularly. I didn't want to be hurt again.
Always a bit selfish, Doc. Thinking of your own hurt.
I can't accept your reproach. I was the only one hurt.
You left me without a word, purely because I indulged in a woman's trick to make you jealous. I wanted to be certain that you loved me. Instead, I lost you. I suffered quite a bit, and I probably deserved it.
They are joined by Lily's companion, Hoi Fei, and I'm sorry for mispronouncing that, played by Anna May Wong, conservative Christian missionary Mr. Carmichael, played by Lawrence Grant, who's morally against Lily's lifestyle, avid American gambler Sam Saul, played by Eugene Pillette, opium dealer Eric Baum, played by Gustav von Seivertiz, and I'm sorry for mispronouncing that, stuffy boarding housekeeper Mrs. Haggerty, played by Louise Glosser-Hale, French officer Major Lenard, played by Emile Chotard, and calm, collective, and mysterious Euro-Asian Henry Chang, played by Warner Oland. The passengers are quickly caught up in the violence and politics of the Chinese Civil War going on around them. Shanghai Express benefits from previous von Sternberg and Dietrich collaborations with its relatable ensemble cast that balances out Dietrich's rather cold personality. Particularly, there's Anna May Wong, the first Chinese-American star in Hollywood, and the first to receive international recognition. She's mesmerizing. She doesn't do very much, but you can never take your eyes off her. And she's not made to perform any of the racist Asian stereotypes popular at the time. Actually, Shanghai Express seems mostly devoid of yellowface, instead casting Asians in Asian roles, though I believe most of the actors were Asian, but not Chinese, which is unfortunate, but better than casting a white person in racist makeup. The only yellowface I can recall is Warner Oland, but even his character design doesn't lean heavily into the yellowface look of the time. I still would have preferred an Asian actor, but at least it wasn't as racist as I feared. What can't and probably should never go unmentioned in any piece examining Shanghai Express is its cinematography by Lee Garms. Garms won an Academy Award for his work, though Dietrich claimed von Sternberg was responsible for most of what you see in the movie. Whoever was responsible, they deliver what I would say is the first fully assured and realized look out of the nominees that haven't won up to this point. The whole movie has this soft glow to it that adds to the luxuriousness the movie is aiming for and the glamour of some of its stars, mainly Dietrich, but it also makes use of sharp, moody shadows. This shot in particular has been copied in homage many times. Most famously in
Open Your Eyes.
Yeah, there. Shanghai Express seems to be doing what Casablanca executed much better a decade later, telling a love story in the middle of turbulent, pivotal political events. But unlike the later film, Shanghai Express fails to wring out the intense personal pain and regret of its romantic leads.
You see, once upon a time, we loved each other. We parted, and I threw my life away because I didn't care to bargain for love with words. I haven't changed since then, and neither has he.
You're still in love with him, aren't you?
Yes.
Is he still in love with you?
I doubt it.
It's a perfectly fine love story, but there lies the problem. It's just fine. Like the political story, the love story starts out good, but slowly peters out, leaving you going, that's it? I liked the film, but I was hoping for a political tale with more thrills and a romance with more heart-wrenching drama. The Smiling Lieutenant was based on a 1905 novel and a 1907 operetta book adaptation. The 1931 movie takes place in Vienna, where Lieutenant Nicky, played by Marie Chevalier, meets and falls in love with Turin violinist Franzi, played by Colette Colbert.
You put cheeses in the coffee, such temptation in the tea.
I get a thrill that sends a chill right through me when you pass the toast to me.
There's paradise in every slice of bacon.
And you awaken such yearning when you bake a scrambled egg.
And you put it in every omelette. Breakfast time, this must be done.
Their relationship runs into trouble when Nicky accidentally offends the insecure king and princess of a fictional country after a wink meant for Franzi is intercepted and misinterpreted by Princess Anna, played by Miriam Hopkins. Anna thinks Nicky was laughing at her. To get out of the execution set by the king, played by George Barbier, and I'm sorry for mispronouncing that, Nicky charms his way into Anna's heart.
When I saw Her Highness, so young, so charming, so beautiful, I forgot everything, my rank, my duty, I smiled.
Anna soon proposes, and Nicky is forced to marry her. Nicky's heart still lies with Franzi, and he constantly pushes the princess aside. Nicky's problems snowball until he lands into a resolution which is strangely reminiscent of Grease, of all things. Also directed by Ernest Lubitsch, marking the first time a director saw two of their films nominated the same year, this is such an improvement over 1 hour with you. Though keep in mind, The Smiling Lieutenant came out the year before it. Remember, I'm reviewing these alphabetically, not chronologically. One improvement over 1 hour with you and The Love Parade is the sexism and questionable gender politics are mostly absent here. Chevalier's charm and Colbert's skill as an actress make them a fine romantic duo, though admittedly not as great as Chevalier and MacDonald. You can sense their affection for each other. Their relationship is the heart of the film and carries the conflict as you're eager for them to get back together. Chevalier and Hopkins are great too, but in a different way. Anna is desperate for Nicky's love, but he's not interested. This creates some simultaneously sad and hilarious scenes.
Oh no! Oh no! Married people don't do that.
They don't.
Oh, no.
Married people don't wink.
Yes, they wink.
But not at each other.
Well, what's the use of getting married?
All the philosophers for 3,000 years have tried to find that out. And they failed. And I don't think we'll solve that problem tonight. Good night.
The Smiling Lieutenant is funny, or at least humorous throughout, but my favorite joke had to be this running gag.
We give the girls a ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta when we go out campaigning, and they give us a ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, and so we are not complaining. Ta-ta-ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta.
I found a new commander to obey. I must report for duty right away. She'll never pension me.
The songs suffer this time. I can only recall three. The opening number, which I love for its infectious energy, brought on partially by Chevalier's winning smile.
Two arms, we are used to night alarms. We're always facing powder. The girls give in, we weaken but we win, and march home feeling prouder. We're on a parade each evening in the park. We're not afraid to skirmish in the dark. We're famous near and far for for a ra da 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 da. Toujours l'amour in the army.
There's this number with Nikki, Franzi, and Anna. It's okay, but I do enjoy it for how well it sells the romance.
You devil! Say you love me!
Believe me, you are the one!
You brute, you! I could shoot you, you son of a gun!
You put madness in the moonlight. He and he in each caress. In every sigh, you put such high explosive. I send out an SOS.
Finally, there's one song near the end that gives Colbert a chance to shine solo. Again, I don't love it, but there's a certain charm to it.
Jazz up your lingerie, just like a melody. There's music when every ribbon has a flowing rhythm. We're laced in harmony, a silken symphony. It's music and just the right note for you. Color should be seen, let your step-ins have no dull or gray tones. Wear your crepe de chine with some pep-in up to date. Hey, hey, toad!
This one's fun, guys. If you have 90 minutes and need some laughs and some cheering up, check it out. There was a fair amount to choose from this year, but my favorite nominee was The Champ for its touching and genuine look at the redemptive relationship between a father and son. The film that took home the big prize also starred Wallace Beery. It starred a lot of people, in fact. Join me, Lewis Stone, Wallace Beery, Joan Crawford, Greta Garbo, and Lionel and John Barrymore for the star-studded ensemble drama Grand Hotel.
Grand Hotel. Always the same. People come, people go. Nothing ever happens.
Hey everyone, hope you enjoyed all that. Please let me know what you thought about the review and the movie in the comments below. If you liked the episode, please hit the like button, and if you're new to the channel, please subscribe. A link to my film blog can be found in the description below, and you can also find me on Twitter at CinemaPackRat.